Well, good morning. I want to welcome everybody to our event, Digital Media in the AWS Cloud. This is our second year doing this event. I don't know if you were here last year. We ran this at the Sofitel nearby, and it was a half-day event, and it went so well. We decided to there was enough information to cover that we wanted to expand it to a full day. And so I just wanted to cover a couple housekeeping pieces of information. First of all is the Wi-Fi network. If you have a connected device and you want to get on the network, here's how you can access it. And then if you're posting anything to Twitter, we have a hashtag for the event, which is #AWSDigitalMedia. Also, please check your phones, ensuring that they won't ring during the presentations. I appreciate that. There's really just a few main components to the event today. We're going to have an opening keynote session that's going to then lead us into lunch. And then from lunch, we're going to get into individual sessions on really the overall media workflow. And then we'll end up at our reception in the afternoon. One of the things I wanted to note is when you came in, you received an event evaluation form. What we're going to do is on those forms during the reception, we're going to then do drawings for free AWS training courses. And so AWS now offers formalized training. These are multi-day training courses. And these are specifically for our architect course that we'll be doing drawings for. And so that's going to be something we do during the reception. With that, I'd like to introduce Dr. Werner Vogels. Dr. Werner Vogels is Amazon.com's Chief Technology Officer, and he is responsible for the innovative solution for Amazon's global customers. And with that, Mr. Vogels. Great, thank you.
Morning. Actually, I want to emphasize something that we just said. You know, as a company, and I'll talk a bit more about that later, so Amazon strives to be Earth's most customer-centric company. Yeah, and that's easy to see how that works in the world of retail. Yeah, but it also works in the world of sort of cloud service providers. And we'll talk a lot more about that later. But one key component in that is that customers are central. And that means that we really, absolutely, totally rely on your feedback. Yeah? Without your feedback, we cannot improve these events. Without those feedback, we cannot improve our services. And so it is absolutely crucial. Yeah? And if you want to influence sort of also the direction of AWS, talk to us and give us feedback. I'll try to hammer on this over and over again, because it's you actually that will be in the driver's seat, both you know, how these events evolve, but also how Amazon and AWS evolve. And so we closely listen to our customers. With that, so my talk actually is really just glue. Yeah, and a glue between two customers, PBS as well as Disney that have been willing to actually come and talk to you today about how they are using the cloud. And probably when you walk away today, you will remember their talks. Yeah, and I'm just the piece in between that sort of tells you a little bit about what's the state of the world of AWS. So what is the state of the world of AWS at this moment? So we have 8 regions around the world, a very large number of POPs. I don't know how many edge locations do we have at the moment? 35. And so that number is continuously growing. We're not stopping. We're actually developing new regions. You may expect us to actually open up more and more regions around the world as just time progresses. And over time, you should assume that most of the map will be colored in one way or another. Yeah? Lots of customers, yeah, and probably you initially have heard maybe about the Amazon Web Services, mainly because we power a lot of the young sort of internet businesses. Although most of these businesses actually have become, in my eyes, at least pure essential tools in our productivity of every day. Yeah, and I remember recently I was being interviewed, and there was a business journalist, and I was talking about business applications within the cloud, SAP, and things like that. And in that whole range of applications that we're talking about, I also mentioned Dropbox. And the junior said, yeah, but that's not an enterprise application. He said, yeah, because it just works. Yeah? and so you know, we've become pretty, and especially the newer sort of generation of leaders that is entering the enterprise, is actually is growing up with a number of productivity tools and a number of tools around there to help them do their business that is really, really essential for them, from Evernote to Dropbox to SlideShare to whatever. And all of them are powered by AWS. Yeah, and so, but of course, you know, it's not just the younger businesses that run on this, enterprises just as much. And I'm happy to talk to you over lunch or whatever about the kind of things that we see sort of traditional enterprises do. You know, most of them, you know, although all of them come to AWS with a sort of cost picture in mind, like reducing cost, everyone will tell them that the real reason why they're in the cloud is agility. Yeah, a company like Shell, who is, as you can imagine, it's an oil company, oil and gas company, pretty conservative, traditional company. The reason for them for picking actually AWS as a cloud provider is because their IT department no longer wants to be the blocker. They want to be the ones that actually are sort of enabling innovation, moving fast. And they use traditional core IT production tools for them. Yes, they run things around SAP. Yes, they run things around the Oracle stacks. All of that stuff supported. You know? And of course, you know, many of you and your peers are these days also using AWS. I think there's an ideal match between sort of media companies and the cloud, and we'll get into that more a bit later. I've seen that many media companies are actually really, really interested in actually re-monetizing their content and finding different ways to experiment with content and bringing content in front of customers. And I like to believe that the kind of services that AWS offer allows it to do these kind of experiments and bring things to customers at a very low cost, with a very low risk of failure. And also, you know, at least in the US, you know, the largest enterprise in the US, in my eyes, is the federal government. And they have a cloud-first strategy, as it's called, where they really consider cloud as the first platform for delivering services to citizens. And when they launched their first service, which on top of AWS, which was, come on, I'm blanking out. What was the first service that we... Recovery.gov, which is a website, or actually it's a big analytics site that actually analyzes where recovery money was being spent. And it's a combination between SharePoint as the workflow engine, business objects from SAP to do the analytics, and then GIS systems from ESRI. So all of this, you see that these are big systems being built by out of off-the-shelf components. Not all of these things are actually custom development. When they launched that first system, they actually put out a press release to make clear to the world that one of the reasons why they were picking AWS was that they had, for their investigations, determined that the security at AWS was superior to what they would be able to achieve themselves. And with launching that first service, they wanted to make sure to the world that the federal government, which has pretty high standards in terms of security, was completely satisfied with the security that AWS was offering. By now, we've more than 150 of these agencies on top of AWS, and I'm a proud collector of all these seals now. Analysts have their say also about AWS. I think we're... I'm not always sure whether they... Given the speed at which I think the cloud world is moving, whether you know these are just snapshots in time and they're just models, I think AWS ends up in parts of quadrants and things like that I think are pretty positive, and it's sort of an indication of where our business is going. This is a metric that we use inside Amazon to give an indication of how the business is actually growing. Yeah, and so at the end of each year, we've counted the number of objects there is in Amazon S3, which is a simple storage service. And all the dark blue ones are the ones actually at the end of each fourth quarter. And more importantly than the absolute numbers, because at the end of last year, there were 760 billion objects. I mean, that's a lot. Even for Carl Sagan, billions and billions will be a lot. You know, we have seven. Because now, at the end of actually Q2, this is half a year later, we're already at trillions. Yeah, and so this is more importantly than the absolute number is sort of the trend that you see here. It is clear that it's accelerating, and I like to believe that the growth is actually better, more than exponential in terms of customers using our storage service. Of course, you folks are mostly interested in how actually matches this up with what you do in terms of the media world. And I can draw all sorts of architecture diagrams and stacks about what are the different services that live in the Amazon world. I thought I'd turn that around a bit on its head and look at sort of the post-production world and look at the two pieces in there. You know, one digital asset management and the other media distribution. But, you know, our customers will actually give you much better details on that and how they are actually using these services. But let me just look at some of where does this result in. So if at the core component of the media asset management is how to get your services into the cloud, you know, there's Amazon Direct Connect, which allows you to connect on-premise with your own, with the Amazon Cloud. There's import-export, being able to ship things to AWS. Important, actually, is the ecosystem. Yeah, I like to say that the Amazon Cloud is a lot more than just AWS. It's really important that you realize that Amazon gives you the basic building blocks. And they are pretty core functioning building blocks. And it's often our partners that are actually building management systems on top of it, that are building, that are extending and using these functionality to extend the kind of things that they can do for you. And so our customers, or our partners, are really important. Aspera, I think Michelle will be giving a talk later on today, have been a great partner with us from the beginning. And actually, I was talking to some of our media customers last night, and they were really raving about how much Aspera has helped them actually use the cloud, start using the cloud, actually. And so they've been a great partner to us, but also other companies like Signiant and Riverbed help customers get their media and get their data into the cloud. Storage, of course, with the simple storage service, Amazon S3. But also there's a new service which we recently launched called Amazon Glacier. And Glacier is intended for cold storage. Basically, that kind of data that you read, that you write once, and that you may read in the future. Yeah, and some of the media that you may be using, you may be actually storing it in Glacier, and you may never read it again. Maybe only under disaster recovery scenarios. But you know, many of you have vaults with many assets that you actually want to have faster access to than that you would have now on tape. Glacier gives you access to content in a matter of hours. 3 to 5 hours is sort of the gold standard there. It allows you to build many different architectures. Most importantly is actually the price point at which we're able to do this. This is 1 cent per gigabyte per month. That's sort of a revolution that allows you to think very differently about how you are actually going to use these sort of digital storage services. And I'd like to believe that Glacier has been received quite positively by many of our customers in the digital media world. Encoding, Amazon as AWS, we deliver you the core CPU functionality there. Virtual machines called Amazon EC2. But many of our customers are actually, or many of our partners are actually providing services on top of EC2, really targeted towards the media in the industry. Workflow, yeah, so on top of that, there's media, we provide workflow services, and we'll get a bit more into the simple workflow service, because there's a few unique things around this. Often you think about public cloud is that we are only running things in the cloud. But many of these services that we're actually delivering allow you to run both on-premise as well as in the cloud. We talked earlier on about Direct Connect, matching on-premise with connections into the cloud. Simple workflow service as well allows you to run tasks on-premise, on mobile, and as well as in the cloud, and gives you a framework on top of that that allows you to build pretty complex and extensive workflow systems. Again, we deliver the basic functionality there, while many of our partners are extending that specifically for media companies. So if you look at the if you then look at the other side, more of the distribution side, of course, again, there is just the delivery through web servers and web environments, and that EC2 and auto scaling and load balancing are really good at. But also many of our partners, again, companies like Adobe and Wozwa, delivering great media distribution services as part of what's called AMIs, Amazon Machine Images, running on top of AWS. Yeah, there's databases, traditional databases, relational databases, that are in a framework called Relational Database Service. And very excitingly, we also offer something called DynamoDB. And I'll go into DynamoDB a bit later, because that's a revolutionary different service. It's a NoSQL service, but also the way that you use this database is radically different than that you use any other database. With DynamoDB, we really focused on making sure that there is zero administration, that you can just configure the database how you really would want to configure one, saying, this is the amount of capacity, this is the amount of performance, this is the sort of performance I want out of the database. And then behind the covers, we take care of everything else. So databases are playing an important role. Of course, CloudFont with 3-5 POPs is our distribution engine for many of our customers, delivering static content, delivering live streaming, and these days also extensions for doing dynamic content as well. And then again, this Amazon delivers a number of core services in terms of management on top of this, like EMR, where we make it very easy for you to manage large Hadoop clusters and to run your analytics engines. But again, many of our partners delivering extensive services on top of this, like Uyala, for example, that does multi-CDN management and things like that. And then a whole range of management services on top of this. Yeah, so this is just just to lull you asleep a little bit, to make you realize that actually the presentation I was gave was sort of boring. Because now, actually, I get the chance to actually introduce John Bradshaw from PBS, who is going to tell them about how they're using AWS. Thank you much, John.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Vogels. It's actually it's fun to be here. I actually came last year, and the venue, as Reed mentioned earlier, was a fair bit smaller. But you know, it was sort of in some sense, our coming out party. 4 years ago, when I arrived at PBS, we were in sort of a very different place, and that's a lot of what I'm going to spend talking to you about today is sort of the journey over the course of the last 3 or 4 years with Amazon and how they really have enabled us to be where we are today. First of all, so I'm John Brensel, VP of Products at PBS, and just sort of as a level set, what that means for us is I run all of engineering, QA, product management, and sort of UX and visual design for all of our sort of digital products, with the exception, you know, of some of the stuff going on our kids' side. So a little bit about PBS, because, you know, as many of you have sort of grown up with PBS like I have, you know, the PBS of today is in some ways a little bit different than the PBS I sort of grew up with. Today we're about 600 employees located in the East Coast in Arlington, Virginia, near sort of Reagan National Airport. We are a nonprofit member organization, so the important piece here is essentially we are owned by our stations, as opposed to us owning our stations as some networks would operate. The dues that we collect are in turn used to acquire content and build infrastructure, you know, that we utilize in the digital side today. Producers and stations, as I mentioned, are not owned by PBS. We have generally three lines of business: general audience, kids, and education. I focus mostly on the general audience side, although increasingly we're doing work on behalf of those other two lines of business. And probably last and most important, and I tell this story every time, you know, is you don't listen to us on the way to work. I cannot count the number of times I've been in a party and I say, and then people ask me, well, where'd you work? And I say, oh, I work at PBS. And they're really excited. They say, oh, great. You know, I really love that company. I listen to you every morning on the way to the office. No, we don't do radio. We do TV, you know, moving pictures kind of thing. So that is NPR, obviously our sister media organization, albeit on the radio side. We do moving pictures. In terms of sort of reach and recognition, you know, PBS really is, you know, I was actually very surprised. I didn't even know this when I came to PBS 4 years ago, is what an impact and what a role that we sort of play in sort of, you know, in the American culture and society. So today, in terms of that reach, probably most importantly for me is that we are the number one sort of most trusted brand in America on the media side, sort of confirmed every year in the Roper poll. And so that allows us to do things and to talk to people in sort of very different ways that many other companies cannot. In terms of, so we do about 2 million units last year on iTunes. We have about 120 million monthly viewers, more than 5 million downloads of PBS apps to date. We have 360 stations scattered around the country that I sort of noted earlier. We won 32 Emmy Awards last year. We do about 140 million videos streamed a month, which frankly is just an astounding number for me. And we sort of reach into 91% of American households. So we do this with a set of iconic brands that you may or may not realize really were all PBS, but again, sort of brands, as I alluded to earlier, that sort of that I grew up with. Frankly, my dad made me, you know, watch McNeil, Lehrer, NewsHour as a kid, and then I spent the next 20 years not watching PBS as a result in my own sort of silent rebellion. So, you know, so Nova doing sort of science programming, Antiques Roadshow for the collectors out there, lots of great nature programming, Masterpiece Theater that is really going to allow us to sort of start to reach, surprisingly, some of that younger demographic that we've historically missed with hits such as Downton Abbey and Sherlock, Frontline, sort of that magazine-style news show, Austin City Limits bringing sort of a concert programming, and so on. So, in terms of, actually, I think I missed, may have missed, can go back one slide. Actually, yeah, that is the right one. There we go. So, just by the numbers, this is sort of a glimpse of sort of where we are today. And video, obviously, as for many of you, is sort of that fastest moving, sort of growing and changing facet of our business today. In terms of overall video, mobile is doing about 1.3 million visitors a month out of 30 million overall. 8.4 million visits actually a month out of 57. The big number for me, and this really is something that has changed a lot in the last 2 years, is that in terms of overall streams, and this is largely driven by the kids' side of our business, they are now streaming nearly 60% of the videos watched are now mobile out of overall sort of desktop experience. And this is up from essentially zero 2 years ago before we launched the iOS app for that audience. And hours watched still is predominantly desktop, but again, that is changing very quickly. Sort of a little bit of a bird's eye view of sort of bringing this back to the topic at hand about Amazon. So 4 years ago, when I came to PBS, we were like probably many of you are today, and certainly a year ago when I spoke at this conference, this is very true. We were your traditional big iron IT. Shop. You know, we had an IT department, we had a machine room down in Alexandria, and we had rack space that was full, and I told them we were going to be launching a video service within a month, and they said, what? And, you know, it's going to take us, you know, 2-3 months to procure the hardware and rack it and stack it and all of that, and I'm going, well, that's not really going to work. So, you know, they sort of got, you know, much, very easily for me, you know, they sort of said, you know what, why don't you just, you know, you go figure it out on your own. And I said, great. And so we sort of dipped a toe in the water with Amazon and then ultimately jumped in head first or did a belly flop, depending on how you sort of look at it. But this is sort of where we are today. You know, sort of five Amazon accounts we use to sort of segregate our business. With 375 EC2 machines. Last year I spoke a little bit about, You know, this has become so easy to provision infrastructure that I was really worried about our costs getting away from us because all of my developers, you know, when in doubt, they would just say, oh, let's just add another machine. And so the good news is, you know, good for me, maybe not so much for Amazon, but, you know, is that we've sort of, you know, been able to cap that since last year, make heavy use of a variety of Amazon services, the Elastic Load Balancers, Elastic IPs, certainly the MySQL as a service on the RDS side, Elastic Block Storage. We have nearly 200 S3 buckets where we store all of our video. 20 CloudFront distributions, and a big change since last year, and we're very excited about, is sort of the advent of the Cloud Search service. And we're starting to, you know, to use that in a much bigger way. The big applications that we are running today in systems, sort of our main video content management system, our media ingest and transcoding operation, I'll talk a lot more about later, our national portals, both video and sort of represent content across the PBS system, our next sort of generation publishing platform, which we call Bento, we've just launched in the last few months out on Amazon. That is ultimately going to be hosting a lot of our stations as well as our producers. Today, all of our, this is sort of a, you know, our I'll call it our sort of legacy sort of approach to how we sort of hosted content, is all of our producer websites are hosted really as on individual EC2 machines. We let the producers manage them themselves, and we're trying to sort of bring that, migrate them all into the Bento platform, really as sort of a managed application service. TV Schedule is probably the most popular service and sort of the, you know, sort of core to many of our users' experience and why they sort of come to pbs.org. And last but not least is, you know, some of the work that we're starting to do around search. We actually launched on our mobile web experience, we went out of the gate using Cloud Search as opposed to the search platform that we used for the rest of our portals today. So jumping in a little bit to some of the applications that, you know, that we're sort of providing with all of these infrastructure and services is the first big one that we launched with several years ago. We launched our iPad app, shown there on the right, in late 2010, and then followed it very quickly with an iPhone app also for video in early 2011. So the iPad app went on relatively quickly and was, I think, twice. It was sort of number one in the iTunes store and then went on to win a Webby Award. Using that sort of experience, we also then went on and launched a PBS Kids video app. This was actually done as a universal app, sort of learning from our previous experience. And it was incredibly popular, and this is really—it's this particular product that really has driven the usage and the adoption that we've seen, and it's sort of become one of those classic passback apps where mom hands her 3G iPad or now iPhone back to son or daughter in the back seat, and they are now watching that sort of trusted content that they had previously been watching on the television. Now they're in the doctor's office or in the car. Or so on. And that really has caused that sort of 60% share of mobile that the kids, that we've sort of seen for the kids' audience. And here you see there on the left is sort of on for the general audience business, which again is the front line and NewsHour and so on, sort of that share across obviously predominantly iPad. This is mostly long form content, so a fairly typical distribution that you might see. And you see a much higher percentage there, you know, of sort of usage on the right by sort of the small form factor devices for the iPhone and the iTouch on the kids audience. You know, mobile kids really is certainly very little long form content. It's really a big long playlist of 30-second clips that kids can sort of click around in. You know, many of your children actually may actually use these apps. So, sort of big changes since last year when I sort of, both of those apps I sort of spoke about last year, and we've really been able to do some great things in this last year. 4 years ago, or actually for the last 4 years, really until this, until last month, our experiences all required Flash, which is obviously significant for the mobile audience in that it sort of precluded any sort of offering on the web, per se, at least for iOS. Fortunately, we have the iOS apps for those with those devices, but we essentially precluded also the Android because Flash didn't really play that particularly well on most Android devices. So what we've done, we just launched, soft launched about a month ago, is we came out with a true responsive design mobile web offering for not only the national portal, but now as of last week also for some of our station portals. And we modeled this really after, sort of the poster child for responsive design in the industry, the Boston Globe site. So where you truly can resize the view portal on the browser and you can see things rearrange and functionality and text sort of be selectively revealed as capabilities of the device or the view portal sort of changed. And we've really been very excited and very proud of sort of some of the things that that's going to start to enable us to do, which this truly was, from the get-go, a mobile-first exercise. And so now we are starting to see this convergence between the desktop videos or that flat classic Flash experience, and then now from the mobile website coming in with sort of HTML5, and we're seeing a convergence so that I hope, here in the next 12 months, we will see a deprecation of that desktop Flash-based mobile experience. I'm sorry. Desktop Flash-based experience to the one we really have just a single stack for the delivery of video, regardless of device, and so on. So in the first 30 days, obviously the numbers are very, very small. On the mobile side, you sort of see the distribution by device. So obviously iPhone and iPad are clearly still the dominant players, but very quickly, you already see the Kindle Fire showing up there. And we just expect that to continue to increase. And those, of course, are hours watched in the last 30 days. Another thing we're very excited about, and again, this is part of our sort of product and technology strategy for sort of going forward and how we sort of address the mobile market, is what we're doing around the Kindle Fire. So we just submitted to the Amazon store, I believe last week, a Kindle Fire app. And we took our mobile web experience and we wrapped it in a thin sort of app wrapper and submitted it there. And this is going to allow us to come up with targeted, co-branded offerings, customized offerings for many of the different device platforms without having to view this through the economic lens of doing a native app development exercise, which would have been, for our limited resources, cost prohibitive. So that as a hybrid app, we're going to start doing that more and more. And frankly, if we were to redo iOS today, at least with the video application that we've got, probably wouldn't do it as a native exercise. We would have done it as a mobile web and then wrapping it for the last few features, which would have changed the economics of that considerably. And going forward, now that we have all of that services infrastructure in place, we're starting to turn our sights towards the over-the-top market. All the usual suspects, Xbox, Roku, Google TV, Boxy, and then, of course, other wrapped experiences that, for the mobile market that I alluded to earlier. To do all of this, of course, required a considerable exercise around transcoding. And we sort of, we got a bunch of engineers around. Of course, our first instinct is, this will be fun. Let's build it ourselves. So we spent about a month learning that that's really, really hard to do. And so we took a couple of abortive steps and ultimately settled on a relationship with Zencoder in our case. This is about 2 years ago. And so today, what we're doing is ingesting sort of what we would call at least web mezzanine files, sort of 2 to 5 megabit quality, that which is required for the highest quality stream that we offer today. We transcode to sort of multi-bit rate streams. You can see sort of some of the particulars from web, iPhone, iPad, sort of the typical app specs shown there, and then as well as for the Xbox, and then transform to that final sort of streaming format. Whether it be smooth streaming for Microsoft or Apple's HLS spec. And again, this has all been sort of provided sort of out of the box by Zencoder, which runs sort of encoding as a service. We sort of built our video transcoding service is essentially a configuration wrapper around that. One of the big problems we've really focused on this year too, as many of you I'm sure have worried about, is the looming FCC deadline, which is goes live here in the next couple weeks around closed captioning. And PBS is probably held to a higher standard with respect to closed captioning, given our history in this space, than many. And so we will be coming out, and actually we've started to launch some of the features under the covers here in the last week or so around that. So we're accepting SAMI, DFXP, or broadcast on the input side, and then on the output side for web, we're doing a sidecar DFXP, and then obviously for mobile, because the device support really isn't there yet for that, we're muxing that right into the transcoded output, which Zencoder provides to us. The beauty of all this, of course, is, and we've actually done this a couple of times already, we've had to retranscode our entire catalog because of something we discovered on the quality side, or because of something we've learned in it, or whatever reason, we've been able to do this just in the space of a couple of hours. And what really made all that possible, of course, is Amazon, in this case under the covers for what they provide to Zencoder. So what this really has meant for us, and so we're obviously a big consumer, or at least big for us, a big consumer of Amazon's CloudFront service. So the streaming for HTTP and RTMP streaming support today. I spoke at a conference in Amazon conference in New York earlier this year, and I made the mistake, which I'll never make again, of going on right after one of the social media guys. In this case, it was Pinterest. And their numbers, you can always add a couple of zeros to the end of it, and sort of, come up feeling sort of relatively, puny and small by comparison. I was talking to the guy from Pinterest there, and I told him we use CloudFront. He goes, how much do you use? And I said, well, we'll do about 40 petabytes this year. And he goes, wow, that's a lot. We only do 25 a month. And I'm going, no, that was 40 a year. So his numbers were obviously a lot larger than ours. But, in the course of the last 2 years, we've gone from essentially, about half a petabyte a month to now we're doing about 2.5 a month. In the two spikes there you see, of course, are the re-premiere in December of Downton Abbey, the first season, and then the follow-ons season two of Downton Abbey, which caused this sort of huge fluctuation in our streaming. There we go. So, final slide. So this is really sort of how it all sort of, comes together in our sort of video service architecture. And I'm just going to breeze through this relatively quickly and again highlight some of the points that I've made sort of earlier. Starting there at the bottom, producers and stations deliver content to us in a couple of different ways. Shown there on our left is our sort of media operations center. We have our entire sort of catalog or archive of video that is stored out on a media storage area network, very traditional sort of approach to that, to the extent that we want to bring that online, comes through our MOC, and we now just in the last month have started making use of Aspera, which was already being used a lot between stations and producers for the true mezzanine ingest. We've now started using that to sort of get it up into our video transcoding service. Or producers can, of course, come in directly to our admin and upload it from there. We have a fair number of smaller ones that do that, and our stations may do that as well, again, using sort of an Aspera, sort of in this case, the plugin through the web-based interface. Comes into our sort of publishing system. Video transcoding service really is that core engine of what sort of drives that. Zencoder, again, is really the heart of our transcoding strategy today, which then disseminates all of that content out to CloudFront and our Cove API, which when stitched together with the TV schedule service, sort of ultimately enables the capabilities in all of our sort of different applications and devices and experiences, which today, of course, is mobile web, the native apps, and then desktop experiences, and then really is on the verge of sort of expanding by an order of magnitude in some of these over-the-top sorts of experiences. So with that, I will conclude, and I don't know if there, if we are inviting questions. Certainly would take any now, or I will turn it back over to Dr. Vogels to sort of continue the discussion. So, any questions? Anybody has? Yes. Oh, I'm sorry. Yeah, Cove. I tried to get rid of some of those product names, internal product names. It was the name that was developed 4 years ago to describe our video CMS system. It stood, I believe, for Comprehensive Online Video Ecosystem. So it's really just our video CMS today. Great question. Originally, no. And this is actually is sort of, you know, we do this a lot. We actually went with a company called The Platform, sort of competitor to Bright Cove, and we built it out because we had no engineering product capability in-house 4 years ago when we launched, and so we had an outside vendor sort of build it on top of the platform, and then we are slowly transitioning off that, and we've essentially rebuilt most of that to serve our particular needs in a much more economic fashion. Yes? Yes, and that's, you know, actually we're just talking about that at breakfast this morning, and you know, I think for the video, you know, it depends on a lot on the type of application. You know, I think on the gaming side where you really need that performance and the responsiveness and sort of a lot of, you know, custom gestures and so on, the native app will continue to be, you know, probably very important. But in our case, for what is essentially a, you know, 1, 2, 3 clicks get you into the video experience and then you're watching it, it's, you know, the hybrid app, I think, is going to serve us very, very well and obviously much more economically. Yeah. Experiments in what sense? Yes. Well, in that's our... The hybrid app that we essentially built for, well, our initial foray is, again, the Kindle Fire app, which is where we're taking our mobile web experience and wrapping that. Now, we're in terms of what we do now with our iOS apps going forward, the question will be, do we slowly replace individual forms and views with web views, or do we replace it wholesale with a wrapped experience? And don't know yet, and we're starting to talk about that. Oh, yes.
Hi, John. Thanks for the presentation. I had a question with regards to the product. Have you guys integrated any monetization platforms into both the apps targeting the kids as well as to the larger general audience? And if not, is it because these apps are supported through the funding that you get from donors? Just curious about that question.
Yeah, a good question. And the answer is yes and no. On the kids' side, we don't, I believe, pursue any monetization strategy at all. Many of those apps or programs are funded exclusively by taxpayers or the Corporation for Public Broadcasting. On the general audience side, we're allowed to do some different things. A lot of that is underwritten by corporate sponsors, so we tend to incorporate monetization experiences around that, as well as we are allowed to sell certain types of advertising, although we're heavily restricted in the types of offers and messages that we can create. From a technology side, how we've addressed that is, I think we've got, you know, LiveRail and MediaLets in the native experience, and then Dart and, you know, some of the more traditional ad platforms for static ads. Anything else? Any other questions? Yes.
What are your plans for innovation for the next 12 months? What are the enhancements of the cloud?
Right. Yeah, I mean, again, I think we're going to continue to turn our sights towards efficiency, you know, making, you know, allowing us to move that much faster and quicker and, you know, maybe reducing the amount of infrastructure that it requires. But probably our biggest challenge is going to be, you know, we still have a number of these sort of technology or product silos that we have now developed, whether it be sort of mobile web, native apps, and sort of desktop. And, you know, where possible and appropriate, continue to sort of, you know, drive a convergence strategy for those so that we can get sort of make, you know, do more with less from a resource perspective. With that, Dr. Vogels?
Thanks, John.
Oh, thank you.
And in case you haven't seen the device yet, you know, the Kindle Fire these days is on fire. Yeah, this is an this is the HD one. You can hold it later if you want to. Actually, you can buy it as well. But actually, it's great that John actually brought it up. There was actually something else he brought up about actually reducing cost. That maybe Amazon wouldn't like it, that these guys are actually, that their bill gets lower each month. And you would be surprised to see that that's actually something that we strive to with most of our customers. Now, for us, this really is a high-volume, low-margin business. And for us, being taking a customer-centric point of view here, if we can help our customers drive their costs down, their bill with us every month, while they continue to, you know, deliver the services that they need to deliver themselves, we're very happy about that. Because actually, it probably means that, you know, in these days where most capital is scarce, you will be more successful as a company. And if we can help you be more successful, it's very likely that you may be our customers for a very long period of time. At least that's where we strive for. Yeah. And so, actually, the reason why I brought the fire up is that I don't know if you saw the live stream of Jeff actually announcing the whole new slew of Kindle HDs and the Kindle Paperwhite and things like that. But in that presentation, he actually had one slide that is extremely important to me, because this sort of signals the way that Amazon thinks about its businesses, not just the retail business, not just the digital content business where the fire is closely related to, but also the AWS business. Yeah, the last one is, we should only win when our customers win. Yeah, and so for that, it's a very different story. If you talk to traditional salespeople in the enterprise software or in enterprise services world, you know, at the end of the quarter, they have a commission, and that's where they all strive for. And so for them, it's important to sell as much as possible to their customers. We don't subscribe to that point of view. Yeah, for us, that feels way more like a sort of secondhand car salesman kind of approach. Yeah? As long as we sold something, I don't really care what happens after that. And if I look back at how, and I've run a large bookshop, you know, I know what it means to actually buy hardware, and I know how it is to actually interact with vendors. And in many of these cases, I felt that I was being held hostage by vendors. Because the only way to drive your costs down was to actually make very long commitments to them. And then pay through the note. That way you could actually get 80% of the list price of that very large piece of enterprise software that you were buying. And then you had to pay through the notes for support that you had committed yourself to for 5 or 10 years out. And you know, with that, you would have to reduce choice for your internal staff as well, because you had just committed to using this one particular platform. And I like to believe that some of the things that we try to do with the Amazon Cloud is to help our customers break through those kind of barriers. Yeah? To be a customer-centric company in the cloud world, in the world of providing services, means that the vendor should no longer be in control. It's the customer who should be in control. And you know, if we have these mobile devices, and you have your phones in your hands, and you buy apps all the time. Yeah, most people buy apps all the time. But you may even have an app number one that actually does exactly the same as app number two, but app number two does it a little bit better. And you know, it costs you $2, and out goes the previous one that you just paid for, and you buy a new one. You're in complete control of your software. Yeah, and then the folks come into the enterprise, and then it's suddenly the IT department that actually tells you what you can do and what you cannot do. And so we like to hope, we hope that we can help IT departments transform themselves into actually being more agile and allowing their workers and their business units to really be in control, instead of that's the vendor that is dictating what's happening. So let me tell you, so there's sort of three things, I think, that sets Amazon as a vendor or as a provider aside from the traditional world, as well as from other cloud providers. I think one, the first and foremost thing that is so important for AWS is flexibility. You can run any operating system, any platform, any piece of enterprise or open source software of any of those, all supported by the original vendors. Yeah, so you can run Linux, you can run Windows Server, you can run SharePoint, you can run Exchange, you can run all the Oracle stack completely supported and certified for production by Oracle with support from Oracle. The same goes for SAP, the same goes for Sage and Lawson and many of the other large enterprise vendors. Any software that you want can run on this platform. We do not lock you into saying, and thou shalt only run Java on this platform. No, you can do anything. It's under your control to do what you want to do. The same is not only flexibility on the technology side, but also flexibility on the business side. Yeah? If we are not delivering the quality of services that you require from us or that we promise to you, you should be able to walk away. Yeah? There should be no legal construct that keeps you locked into Amazon for the coming 5 years. Yeah? It may not be technically that easy to actually walk away, but you should be in control of that. You should be in control of your destiny and not some legal financial construct that keeps you with a provider that you actually do not want to be with. It has to keep us as providers on our toes every day to deliver the absolute best service to you, 100% reliability, yeah, giving you rock-solid performance. And actually also extending our regions and do all those things and promise you to actually continue to do that. You have to keep us accountable. And you do that by continuing to be our customers. And if not, you should be allowed to actually take a different course. And so you have the flexibility on the business side as well. We give you lots of different payment methodologies. We give you spot market. We give you reserved instances. We give you tons of mechanisms to actually drive your costs down. And actually sort of that's sort of the second differentiator of Amazon Web Services over traditional providers or other cloud providers. Yeah? We strongly believe that we should help you drive your costs down, not just where you were with traditional infrastructure, but actually also with AWS. Yeah, we'll often sort of borrow you or let you use some of our solution architects to review your architectures to look for places where you can actually save cost at Amazon. Yeah, because we believe that if we can actually get the cost of this kind of infrastructure to the cost of sort of utilities, so the cost of electricity, when you woke up this morning and you switched on the light in your room, you weren't thinking like, darn, that's going to cost me 5 cents. No, it's not. Because actually, it probably doesn't cost you 5 cents. I hope it doesn't. But it should be, if these kind of costs go to a point where you no longer have to think about it like that, enormous innovation can be driven by it. Because no longer is cost a sort of stumbling block, an obstacle for you to start developing new products and new projects and going to new directions. And so six years now, we've lowered our pricing 20 times without any competitive pressure. And why do we do that? Because we believe that, you know, on one hand, we do a lot of innovations ourselves in terms of getting a lot more efficiencies out of our systems. But it's also our customers that help us gain economies of scale. Now we have hundreds of thousands of businesses using the AWS services worldwide. As you can imagine, that kind of usage gives us a much stronger position to negotiate with our network providers, with our hardware providers, and things like that. And instead of pocketing those kind of better negotiation deals, we give that back to our customers. Because we like to believe that, you know, we're very comfortable in this high-volume, low-margin approach, and that you should be the ones that should actually benefit from running on this platform. So even if you're the smallest startup with only 5 web servers, yeah, you will benefit from this just like the largest corporations are that are actually running on this platform. And so these price reductions, for example, at the beginning of this year, we did, I think in February, some of our larger storage customers saw a 40% drop in their bill in February. And we did compute in March, and some of our customers saw a 30% drop in their bill in March for compute. And we're happy about that. Because we actually like to believe that will help our customers drive a lot more innovation. the third thing that sets Amazon aside is a focus on continuous innovation, and not like backroom innovation where we've got our engineers sitting together and kind of dreaming up what shall we build for our customers. Now, we do a little bit of that as well. But more importantly, what we do is that we continuously evolve a customer in how we innovate. So what you will often see is that when we launch a service, we will launch it in a rock-solid format, because you should be allowed, you have to be comfortable with building your business on top of this service, but we'll do it with a sort of limited set of features. Because we strongly believe that we do not have this crystal ball. We do not know how customers are going to use our services, or how in practice it's best to actually use these services. So we launch it in a sort of limited form, in a reduced form, and then work closely with our customers to drive the product in the direction where they want it to go. Yeah, it's really, you are in control of the direction that our products are taking. And we closely involve our customers with each of the products and allow them to feedback and actually drive the direction of how we are evolving this. Why are we doing this? Because, again, we strongly believe that it should be the customer. We are building things for you. So you should be in control of the kind of things that we're building for you. Cloud actually revolutionizes a lot of the technology and the way that we're building applications. So you should be, we should be closely aligned with you as how you are going to use these technologies. So now if you look at the kind of things that we've been doing in the past years, this is sort of a summary slide of that. Each year, more and more, we're delivering more new big features and more services. And if you just look at this year, you know, the first quarters of this year, each of those quarters, we launched about 24, 25 different new features and services. In this quarter, we're very well underway to that as well. And I like to believe that we'll end up this year with way over, with more than 100 new features and services added to our platform. And most of these are actually driven by you, by customers. And that's the most important part. So let's look at a few things that I think are important that we kind of extended in the past year. I think we did a lot of new work around virtual private cloud. I think this is sort of one of the stepchilds in terms of public knowledge. Virtual private cloud is an extremely important tool for many of our customers to cordon off a piece of the cloud, make it their own, assign their own addressing blocks to it, connect it if they want to back to their own on-premise environment, and you have total control of that. The resources that are in there can only communicate back to either your own data center or through all sorts of networking rules can communicate to the outside world. You can be public and private subnet and things like that. You have total control over the networking in the cloud there. Direct Connect is something that we launched this year where there's many places around the world where you can actually get 1 or 10 gigabit connections directly into the AWS cloud. Many of our customers using this to actually transfer data from their on-premise into the cloud without having to rely on the public internet. Storage Gateway is another thing that we've done this year, which allows you to actually build, take this VM that we'll give you, install it on-premise, connect your own disks to it, and we'll automatically back up those disks into the cloud and in a format that actually allows you to recreate volumes of those backup disks, not only on-premise, if that's what you want to do, but also in the cloud. So you could actually restart easily from data that you had on-premise, but then restart in the cloud. Again, this is a sort of on-premise and in-the-cloud combination. Simple workflow, I talked about it a bit earlier. Again, it's important there to see that it's not just on-premise, they're not just in the cloud, but there is also an on-premise if you want to actually run some of your workflow components inside your own data centers, for example. There is a lot of, this is another one, this is actually Identity Federation. Again, it's where the identity management systems in the cloud, which are very fine-grained, allow you to give very fine-grained control over exactly what particular individuals in your organizations are allowed to do, but we'll allow you to hook it up to your own identity systems such that there can be a single sign-on that actually then assigns roles using identity and access management in AWS. And this sort of trend of on-premise with your own organization, with your existing environment, and in the cloud is something that is not just us, but you'll hear more today from some of our partners as well, who, for example, do transcoding services on-premise, because that's something that they've been doing for quite a while. Elemental, I think, is one of those. And actually are able to sort of extend those on-premise environments into the cloud in a seamless way. And so it's a trend that you'll see more and more happening. DynamoDB is sort of our poster child for doing databases completely differently. I'll talk a bit later about how actually DynamoDB works and what is so new about it, but Cloud Search is something that John happily already mentioned. This is one of the things that I'm actually kind of, I'm really happy about, because it actually solves a pain point for many of our customers. I'm a bit embarrassed that we did it so late, because you know, when after that we sort of more and more start thinking about it, search is everywhere. I mean, there is no website without search. There is no app on your phone without search. There is no application that does not have search. That means that actually all of our customers were running quite a few search services themselves. Amazon.com, one of the customers on top of this platform, ran 65 different services, search places where you could search. And all of our customers were considering this as being actually great pain, because they were, it's all either Lucene and Solr driven, or it is actually some commercial. It's hard to actually configure. It's hard to scale out in terms of requests. It's hard to scale out in terms of data. And Cloud Search is all of that kind of things behind the covers. And most of our customers that have started using Cloud Search are going like, fine, I no longer need to do that. And again, Cloud Search, I think, is innovating quite well in terms of adding new features and things like that. Many of you will have to high I/O environments. We have added provisioned IOPS to our environment for, where you don't necessarily, if you really want to constrain, if you really want to guarantee the amount of I/O that you need between sort of our storage servers and between your compute units, we give you provisioned IOPS. I just saw a blog post from the guys at Parse. They are a very innovative new mobile platform, very successful. I think there's about 35,000 applications running on top of that platform. They moved over to provisioned IOPS, and they've cut down the end-to-end latency towards their customers by 50%. There's no internal spikes anymore in terms of their databases. And actually, they no longer, what they needed to do in the past, was sort of warm up databases for new customers. They no longer need to do that. Some of our customers are running massive databases themselves, and they want to know you not use the RDS environment. For example, they're running either Cassandra or Mongo, and we give them high I/O instances to make sure that they can get all the I/O that they need on a local server as well. And there's programming environments, SQL Server and .NET. You can do PHP and Git. There's many of these things. And as last, I want to point you to something called the AWS Marketplace. This sort of gives you the familiar Amazon environment of actually being able to buy cloud software by many of our partners, tested by Amazon, making sure that you know there's no viruses and things like that, and that these are actually companies that are reputable and actually have a customer base and things like that, with reviews as well. And on the other hand, allowing many of the ISVs in this world to very quickly get their software that can be run in the cloud in front of customers. We really give you sort of a one-click experience there, where one click on the button actually launches that particular software for you in the cloud. And then Glacier is something that we already touched on earlier, and I'd like to leave it with that. With that, many of these new things that we've built and all of these new innovations actually help quite a few of our customers drive their innovation as well. So we're extremely proud that Disney is willing to actually come and talk to us, to come talk to you today. With that, Scarpy Henderson, I would like to invite you to come on stage and actually take the clicker. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Vogels. It's a pleasure to be here, and we at I'm responsible for technology and video platforms for the Disney ABC Television Group, which is sort of the umbrella organization around these networks, which many of you know. Combine these networks and a scrappy outfit on the East Coast called ESPN, we make up the media segment of the Walt Disney Company. We've actually been using AWS for quite some time, and we have a number of pretty innovative applications that are really well suited. And just sort of before I launch into sort of my primary talk, I wanted to call out one that I was mentioning earlier today, and Brian DeBoer actually is in the audience, built for Dancing with the Stars, an amazingly slick voting application for that show on top of AWS, and that was sort of really the beginning of us sort of utilizing it more and more. But the reason we're here today is to talk about media and specifically digital video. We have been at the Disney ABC Television Group really pioneers in making our content available on as many platforms as possible for our users. I think it's worth noting that and we really sort of use this as the beginning of this revolution, if you will, for digital video, October 2005, when Bob Iger and Sweeney and Steve Jobs announced the deal to put our sort of best shows, if you will, into iTunes and allow people to download and watch that on Apple devices. And the reason that's important is not just because it's sort of we were the first, but internally and sort of how we look at digital assets and how we look at the business completely changed that way, that day. And we, because of that effort, were forced as a company to work through issues like licensing and guild issues and legal issues around digital video, which really sort of paved the way for everything that came later on. So on the heels of that, and because of all of that work, we launched in May 2006 the ABC Full Episode Player. This was the first of its kind streaming ad-supported, if you will, free to the user application on the internet, where we allowed our top shows, in this case Lost and Desperate Housewives and Grey's Anatomy, to be consumed on your desktop. And we sort of built on that on that momentum. In April 2010, we launched for the iPad. We launched the same sort of application, native to iOS. This has been an absolutely an enormous success for us, and we have learned quite a bit around sort of what it means now to build in a multi-platform ecosystem. What are the complexities around it? And we think that these touch devices, these mobile devices, are going to be a large percentage of where our video consumption is going to be in the future. Apple, for example, I think it was on the two-year anniversary of the iPad, named this the sixth most downloaded iPad app ever. So this has been fantastic, and we. Just earlier this year, we launched the same application for iPhone, and we extended it to the ABC Family Network also. And that brings us to kids, and really what the crux of the talk is to talk about these three products, which is what we call the Watch suite of applications. And how we went about basically building and partnering with Uplink to enable our content to be delivered into these user experience. So a little bit more about Watch. We launched it on June 13th. It's available on iOS and on the web. It is in partnership with Comcast. This is sort of, many of you know this as a TV Everywhere offering, if you will. It allows Comcast subscribers to log in using their Comcast credentials and get access to content that is available in Windows exclusively for their customers, as well as gives them access to the live broadcast streams. So we make our linear signal, if you will, available in these applications. So this was basically our task, and it was, I'm not kidding, pretty daunting when we started going down this list, because there was a number of things that were introduced with this product that we sort of did not have to deal with on the APC product, on the on-demand product. And the first one was that this was clearly going to be, from the very get-go, a multi-platform application. We had to be able to scale it, basically, to all the sort of core devices where we expected our users and kids to be watching the content. We had an enormous library of on-demand content that we need to sort of get and deliver into these devices. So we were jump-starting, if you will, the whole catalog at the same time. We had this potential complexity of having to source our live signal from multiple locations. And so we had to figure out what that meant from an infrastructure standpoint. We have live East and West Coast feeds, you know, based on your time zone, because we had to be synchronous with broadcast. We have all sorts of legal and rights issues associated with our live feeds. This could be anything from content that's not licensed to be delivered over broadband based on sort of more older or existing deals that we have in place. Or it could be, for example, commercials that are embedded into the live stream could A, either not be cleared, or we might not want them in there because it's hard for us to monetize it. For those of you familiar with how linear television is monetized in the C3 window using the Nielsen currency, one of the biggest issues today is that within that window, it's hard for Nielsen to actually measure the viewing that happens off of the television set on all of these devices. So if we can't monetize advertising in a linear signal, we obviously don't want it in there. And so that was another thing that we had to deal with. And so what do we do instead of the sort of advertising that we carry in the linear signal? We want to replace that with dynamic ad serving into the linear signal. And, you know, closed captioning is an absolute requirement, so we need to make sure that that was available for both on-demand and live content. And then we needed really robust security, really robust gating around our content, both within the domestic boundaries of the U.S. as potentially within DMAs, and then we needed to put verification with Comcast on top of all of that. So, as I mentioned, we partnered with Uplink, and a little bit about, you know, I have known Dave, Ken, Ralph, those guys from Uplink for a very long time personally, and we've worked on a number of projects throughout the years. And when we started talking about this problem and I started learning a little bit more about their approach and how they wanted to go about it, it was just like this aha moment. Okay, now I see the path, right? So before, there were basically all of these complexities and challenges, and now, you know, here is the solution. And the solution is pretty significant to us because of what it helps us do. And I think one way of putting it is that when we started talking with them and we started sort of exploring putting this stuff into the cloud, into AWS, is that for me, it's not as much as managing complexity with the cloud, it's removing complexity using the cloud. And that's specifically when it comes to our operations, our day-to-day operations of getting our content, out into these experiences. And the way that, and we're going to bring Ken up, and he's going to talk sort of in more detail and how they do that. But for us, this is basically what the solution delivered us and why it's so impactful to our operations. We only do one encode ever on all of our content, and it runs on all devices, all experiences. We never have to encode anything again. We do low bandwidth signal acquisition of live television, which means that we have no hardware that sits close to our signal. It's all done in the cloud. So think about the fan out that you potentially have to do as you transcode and prepare your content. And if you keep that close to the signal source, the sort of egress issues that you potentially have, we got rid of all of that, in addition to all of the hardware that we potentially had to procure just to encode it. We got automated closed captioning processing and packaging. So if closed captioning is in the broadcast signal, closed captioning is in the stream. We got live on the fly program and ad removal. And this is absolutely key. So at any point in our live stream, in our broadcast day, we can lift any program that we want out of the live stream and substitute something from the on-demand catalog, which means that this content that potentially is not cleared for distribution can now be substituted with something that is cleared. And we didn't solve that sort of the traditional way of duplicating, if you will, the broadcast infrastructure to create a new signal source. We simply do it on the fly in the cloud. And we do the same for ads. So if we don't want the ads to show through the linear stream, we lift them out. And then when you hit playback, we will dynamically add insert into the live stream the substitution ads. The other thing that is pretty slick, and this was such a minor feature, but it was such an unbelievable operational sort of efficiency for us. And I think, you know, the Uplink guys, like, they literally, you know, turned this around in a couple of days for us. We do our signal delay in software, if you will. So we don't encode the East Coast and the West Coast feed. We only encode the East Coast feed because we do have an advantage in the kids programming that it's all it's basically all play out, if you will. There isn't a lot of live elements, and the East Coast and the West Coast feeds, they're basically always the same. So what we do is we sit on the East Coast feed, and then we, in software, basically put the delay in based on what your geographic location is at the client. So we'll say, if you're on the West Coast, add a 3-hour delay to the East Coast feed, and that's where you will start up when you hit play. And so from a management perspective and from sort of the simplification, if you will, of our operations, this was a big, big deal. And then, of course, there's the famous AWS advantage, which is this scale and resiliency that comes with, you know, I think Ken will have this line, but I'm going to steal it. Sorry, Ken. You know, of having an IT department of thousands of people working for us, right? And being able to spin up resources, infrastructure when we need it to specifically address peaks and things like that. So with that, I'm going to welcome Ken Bruick from Uplink to talk a little bit more about their solution.
Thank you, Scarpy. Thank you, Scarpy. As you mentioned, Uplink is the video provider powering the Watch Disney apps, the ABC Player, and the ABC Family apps. And Scarpy did a great job of summarizing a lot of the problems that they needed to overcome with those apps. So we're going to talk about today are two different aspects of the Uplink solution that help solve a lot of those problems. The first one is our single format approach. Scarpy talked a little bit about how we use the same format across all platforms. And then second, I'm going to talk about how we use that single format approach and build services on top of it to simplify business problems, like ad insertion, content replacement, and some other interesting things as well. But first, I'd like to spend a couple of minutes talking about just what it takes to get adaptive video onto a single platform. So right off the bat, there is some type of signal or content acquisition. For live, that can be quite a daunting task. Next, there is upload and encode. Depending on your solution, those might happen in reverse order. Once that content has been put up to the server somewhere for encoding, it needs to be stored, then needs to be encrypted and distributed. That's the traditional video workflow. Next is a very important piece. That is designing and developing the user experience. So for any brand, especially a brand like Disney, it is very important that they get their brand out there, that they have a solid user experience. So this is a huge step that needs a lot of attention to detail. Part of that process of developing the user experience usually involves some type of ad integration. And this is traditionally done all client side. So that involves things like communicating with an ad server, splicing those ads in for playback, and then reporting back in terms of what ads were played. Similarly, there's also a similar effort involved for analytics. Again, a heavy client-side effort to monitor what content was watched, how long it was watched, when it was watched, and report back. The problem with this is you do a lot of work, but then once you go to your second platform, you don't get to reuse much of it. If your second platform doesn't support the same video formats, it has to be transcoded, has to be stored, encrypted, distributed again. Hopefully, your second platform has a new user experience associated with it. And a lot of times that new platform has a different programming language, and so you have to do integration with the ad server and the analytics all over again. Unfortunately, as you go to additional platforms, that work never reduces. And so the problem is, as a content owner, you start seeing these additional platforms as threats, when really they should be opportunities. But as a content owner, you're actually a little bit scared of new platforms becoming popular. Uplink is uniquely positioned to transform those threats into opportunities. So right off the bat, the Uplink solution makes it easier to get onto your first platform. You'll notice the ad integration and analytics pieces are grayed out. Those are things you don't have to do anymore with Uplink. And I'll talk a little bit about how that works in a minute. But essentially, all that work that was traditionally done on the client is now handed off to the server. So even on your first platform, you don't have to do that integration anymore. On your second platform, of course, you don't have to do those things again because it's all automated on the server. But we even eliminate a lot of the other video workflow for you. Because Uplink is using a true single format approach, your content never has to be uploaded again. It's never transcoded. It's not even repackaged in the cloud, which means it's never having to be stored again, encrypted, or distributed again. It is truly a single format approach. I'll explain how that works in a minute. Finally, as you're going to additional platforms, you can see where this approach really starts to save you on money. It's a huge cost reduction, huge complexity reduction. And what this allows content owners to do is to focus on what's most important, designing their brand, designing a user experience in a way that meets and is consistent with the platform that it's on. But as we're developing the solution, we noticed that's still a lot of work for that very first platform. So we did a lot to simplify that effort as well. And I'll talk about how this works in just a moment, but we have a process that we called slicing, which takes all of the complexity out of that. It makes upload, encode, storage, distribution, and encryption simple and easy. It's completely transparent. But because of Uplink's unique solution, we are uniquely positioned to do some other compelling things. Scarpy mentioned one of them, content replacement. This is huge. Again, it's all server-side, so from the client, there's very little development necessary. Similarly, we do closed captioning the same way. All handled server-side, so that the client effort is completely reduced. So going back to those two things, the single format approach and building services on top of that to make running a business easier, those are the things we're going to talk about next. So for the single adaptive format approach, there was one huge challenge that we had to tackle, and that is getting that single format to work on all platforms. If you have a fragmented solution, it has a tendency to poison everything downstream. It's very difficult to ever escape from that fragmentation once it's been introduced into the system. So the way Uplink handles this problem is twofold. There are several platforms that actually support our format natively. iOS, newer Android devices, and Roku can play back Uplink content without any effort. You can toss a URL into a player, and it'll just work. For platforms that don't support Uplink natively, we provide a simple library that will enable playback. So for Disney, in their Watch app solution, they're targeting both iOS and web. In iOS, it's supported natively. On web, they're using Flash with a small Uplink library to enable playback. The rest just works. As we were developing the playback solution, though, we discovered that encoding was kind of a painful process as well. So we came up with a process that we call slicing. I'm going to walk through how that works. So the slicer is a very simple, lightweight application that runs on commodity hardware. There's no expensive, dedicated hardware encoding, hardware encoders. And I believe Disney actually just used hardware that they had laying around. They didn't even have to buy anything. They're just running this on Linux, but the slicer works on all major platforms. What happens is Disney will send us a video file. And this process is exactly the same for both live and on demand. And that pays off later. And we'll get to that in a minute. But what happens is the video comes into the slicer. The slicer analyzes the video. It maintains important metadata, important things like closed captioning, for example. It creates a custom profile set that matches the content. It then chops up the content into smaller pieces of work and sends those up into the cloud in faster than real time. As those pieces are sent up, they're going to our encoders, which are running on EC2. And it's worth mentioning that everything in the Uplink service is running, or all the services Uplink is using are running on top of ELB and Route 53, so it's extremely scalable. The nice part about uploading these pieces and sending them to the encoders in such a way is it allows for parallelization. So what that means is as content's being encoded, it's also being uploaded. Because they're happening simultaneously, encode finishes just seconds after the upload. So the turnaround time is much faster. Additionally, the slicer is, it does a lot more than just cutting up the content. One of the things it does is it encrypts the content, so it's more secure. It also accelerates and manages the upload, removing the need for a third-party uploader license. Because the upload is accelerated, and we do some optimizations there, you're actually using less egress bandwidth. So there's a huge reduction of costs there. And for premium content owners, this process is very beneficial because the mezzanine file never leaves the facility. This is a huge benefit for security. Once the content has been sent to the encoders, it's stored on S3. And we'll soon be rolling out long-term storage using Glacier. We're very excited that that's been released. And then it's distributed through CloudFront. The content's also sent to our CMS for management and organization. CMS is also built on top of EC2. We're using DynamoDB and SimpleDB. And similarly, those can be scaled up as needed. The beautiful part about all of this, though, is none of those details are things that Disney has to worry about anymore. As far as they're concerned, they run the slicer in their facility, and then it just kind of magically goes up to the cloud. And on the other end, the video spits out to their devices, and it just works across all those platforms. So the question is, why is the single format approach helpful? Why does it eliminate threats in terms of new platforms? It's quite simple. Disney has a massive content library. It's huge. And the next time a new platform comes out that is compelling enough for Disney to go to it, they don't want to have to go back and re-encode all of that content. They don't want to have to go back and manage it, deal with security. The Uplink solution removes that threat because now that single encode that they did at the very beginning continues to pay off with every new platform. They're never paying for those things again. Once again, those additional platforms are opportunities, not threats. So the second way that Uplink makes all this work and that we can actually build upon our single format approach is through a paradigm shift. Logic that was traditionally done in the client has now been moved to the server. And this opens up all sorts of compelling things. The first one, which is ad integration and ad insertion. So I'll walk through how this works with Disney, but the concept is similar for all of our customers. Typically, ad integration is a very painful thing for developers. There's a lot of client-side logic, and I'll walk through how that works. But essentially, with Disney, at slice time, they let us know where ad breaks occur. If it's a file, they generally know where all of the ad breaks are in advance. If it's live, they let us know the ad breaks as soon as they get them. Sometimes it's in real time. Meanwhile, the content is being sliced, sent up to our cloud encoders, And on the other end, users are watching video. Once they come to an ad break, this is where things start to get a little bit different. So in a traditional model, once a user comes to an ad break, the client would have logic written in it to go communicate with an ad server, get ads back, splice them in, force the user to watch them, report back to the ad server that it was played, and then resume playback, which is a challenge on a multi-platform play because that's a lot of duplicate logic to write. In Uplink's situation, we move that logic to the server. So instead of the client talking with the ad server, it's the Uplink CMS that talks to the ad server. Now, this is important. What this does is it allows the CMS to handle all of the heavy lifting, but you still get all the same benefits of client-side ad integration. This is not a one-to-many approach. Each user is still seeing unique targeted ads. The CMS, after talking with the ADS, embeds those ads into the stream, giving each user a unique experience. The advantage of doing it this way, besides just from a simplicity standpoint, is great for your users, the audience. They have a better user experience. Because the video is actually embedded in the stream that the users are watching, there's no rebuffering. There's no ramping up in quality. There's no delay during the communication with the ad server. As far as the user is concerned, it was all part of the same video, even though each user is probably seeing different ads. It's a completely seamless experience, and it's the best out there. Similarly, that's how content replacement works. So, and a lot of this comes down to the fact I mentioned early on that the slicing process works the same for both live and on demand. Because of that, it frees us up to do some very interesting things. Live, once it's been captured, is immediately available for on demand consumption without any re-encoding, and vice versa. Content that was encoded for on demand viewing can be dumped into a live signal, and it's completely transparent. No transcoding is necessary. So for content replacement, at slice time, Disney tells us where those ranges of time are that they can't broadcast. They then tell us, they grab a certain asset from their library and tell us to insert it into the stream, and then it's brought out for all users. What's really fun about this is if those VOD assets had ad breaks in them, those are maintained when they're put into the live feed. So you will get targeted dynamic ads inserted into dynamic replaced content. It's incredible. And the user experience is phenomenal. Again, because it's all embedded in the stream, it is very fluid, it's very elegant, and short of holding the device up to the TV, users will have no idea that they're seeing dynamic content. Finally, the third area in which we shift logic from the client to the server is with analytics. So typically for analytics, there's a lot of client-side logic to monitor user interaction, to monitor what video was being played, what bitrate they were seeing, all that type of stuff. We're using CloudFront and CloudWatch logs to be able to monitor all those things. Our analytics servers are also, of course, running on EC2, full load balancing, so they can scale as needed. And so you get all the same benefits of reduced client-side effort. But you also get additional benefits. Going back to the Uplink single format approach, that does quite a bit to simplify the analytics process. In a multi-format, multi-platform approach, typically there is a very complex and expensive data aggregation process, where all of the different videos and bit rates that were gathered from different devices has to be brought together. There's lots of rounding involved. Sometimes there's some data accuracy that's lost. With Uplink, since it's all the same format, that entire process goes away, which means the data becomes available faster than traditional methods, and it's also more consistent than traditional methods. Now, all of this is really nice, but really, what big companies care about is stability. They need a solution that's going to work. And this is why we love things like CloudWatch. CloudWatch is kind of our all-seeing eye into the system. It monitors every single thing that's going on inside AWS. So anytime a server is starting to get behind, if an encoder is slowing down, or even in worst-case situations where a box completely freezes, CloudWatch is there to monitor it and tell us before those things become a problem. We're using SNS and SES to keep us in the loop. Of course, we have a full dashboard for monitoring these things, but even if the system starts to see trends that it doesn't like, it notifies us. And to Scarpy's point, he totally did steal my thunder on this one. Really, people ask us how big of a company we are, and often jokingly, we will say we're quite large because of things like CloudWatch. Having this service enables us to have the capability and the stability of a much, much larger IT staff than what we do have. It's incredible. So in summary, we are absolutely thrilled with the success we've seen in working with both Disney and AWS. It has been absolutely incredible, and really, it's because of the great services that have been made available to us. In order to make the Disney Watch apps function, to be able to meet all the requirements that the Disney group had, we had to come up with a solution for a single format approach, to be able to simplify encoding with our slicing approach, and to be able to move a lot of that client-side logic into the server so that we could make things much easier, like ad integration, content replacement, and analytics. So because of all of these things, Uplink has worked very hard, and I think we have successfully transformed additional platforms from threats to opportunities. Now I'd like to turn the time back over to Scarpy so that he can share some more insights about the Disney Watch apps.
Thanks, Ken. I mean, for us, it's pretty much a no-brainer. It's all about operational efficiencies and the effort that we have around getting our content out the door in a consistent, high-quality way to our audience. And you know, touching on a couple of those points, the single asset approach, I cannot emphasize how important that is and how much easier it makes our operations. The prep, origin, and delivery, that this all happens on Amazon's backbone. There is no moving files around. They are just on the backbone, and it makes all of those things so easy to manage and deal with. And obviously the elastic scale, the sort of the idea of you know, whether it's three networks today or 200 tomorrow, you know, I do not have any reservation about doing that. And that's something that is a tremendous value. You know, the other thing that Uplink does, and which I really like, is that we stop thinking about our content as gigabytes. We start thinking about it as hours. Hours ingested, hours stored, and hours delivered. And for us operationally, that is actually very helpful because that's how we sell it. That's how people within our company talk about it, and we are sort of able to equate, if you will, the operational costs of an hour's worth of programming, and that sort of is a really nice addition. I talked a little bit about converting CapEx to OpEx. I mean, this is sort of the you know. Not having to, you know, literally in our case, if we wanted to do this the old-fashioned way, not only were we calling guys to, you know, to have FedEx drop off servers, but we were calling construction guys because we didn't have any space. We didn't have cooling. We didn't have electricity for the sort of infrastructure that we needed to enable this stuff. So we moved it all into the cloud, and we now sort of pay as we go, so to speak. The other one I already touched on, egress optimization, and that one not only a cost issue, it was just sort of an operational issue. It was one of those things that if we expand this to more than one location, two locations, 200 locations, 300 locations, this is going to be an issue for our partners and sister networks. The new revenue opportunities, the ability to monetize a broadcast stream with dynamic ads cannot be understated. Right now, there is no other way of getting paid for delivering a live stream over broadband because of the measuring issues that we have. And a little bit about sort of what we experience with kids. And I joked with the guys at Disney Channel because we hadn't really done much with the kids networks before. We had been focused on ABC. We'd been focused on ABC Family. And I said, never again will I doubt sort of the power of Disney Channel to launch a product. It absolutely, literally, you know, within a week, we had quadrupled the traffic across everything that we do. And I was telling Ken, the great thing about having this cloud-based is that we just sort of absorbed that spike. It's like it never happened. There was no sleepless nights. There was no scrambling to put more infrastructure in place. We didn't even know that the spike was occurring. We've, since we launched, 7,000 hours of live content that we've ingested and prepared and done substitutions and ad replacements on. We've ingested over 1,000 episodes of kids content. Since June 14th, and this is a staggering number for us, 8.4 million apps downloaded, which is another sort of indication of sort of how popular these devices are with kids and how it reinforces sort of how we look at this business going forward, being multi-platform. 2.2 billion minutes watched since we launched. This is the one that sort of really caught me, and I think you know the PBS is a sort of similar story of the consumption and just how popular this is with kids and kids programming is pretty amazing. So, you know, these are some of the things that we think about, sort of what's next, what do we have to plan for, what's happening, and it all sort of ties back into why it's so important for us to be working with companies like Uplink and with Amazon on this problem, is that we're just getting started. I tell my guys, this is sort of the first inning of a 9-inning game. We're just beginning to touch on this. It's a post-PC future. I mean, we are going to see devices and our users demanding to watch our content on these devices, and we have no choice but to make it available. With that comes device and platform fragmentation. You know what Ken was alluding to, and it adds to complexity. There's just no getting around it. So how do you solve it? And sort of keep your sanity at the same time, I guess is the one way of putting it. And we're going to have more content. We're going to have more partners. There's more complexity. We're going to be asked to deliver higher quality, you know, 1080p on television sets and game consoles. And there's going to be a demand that this is going to be like broadcast. It's going to be the... People are going to expect this stuff to work as well as their television set. It just works. Just turn it on, and it just works. That is going to be the expectation. And that is another complexity of how you deal with that. How do you scale to meet that demand? And all of it basically calls for smarter and more efficient operations. It calls for solutions that Uplink provides. It calls for the scale, the resiliency that Amazon provides, and that's pretty much it for us. Thank you.
Thanks, Capri. Actually, I want to pick up on one thing that Scarpy said, and I'll be talking a bit about, you know, what kind of transformations cloud computing has brought. One thing that he mentioned is going from thinking about gigabytes to hours. Now, if you look at many of the things that I'll show in the transformation, is where there's a sort of an old world where even though you know you want to talk or think in hours, you're forced to think in gigabytes because you're being forced to deal with the physical realities that you're dealing with, instead of actually thinking about business and products and actually being able to live that. I think Uplink guys are really to be applauded for making things really simple. Because if things are simple, then your customers can actually start thinking about innovation much more rapidly and much more freely than having to deal with all the complexities that live underneath them. And if you look at sort of the transformations that cloud has brought, it is not just about saving cost. Although, yeah, I like to do that at the same time. Yeah. For example, if you look at Samsung, when they actually launched there, they make beautiful smart TVs. But smart TVs are one of those things where a smart TV is actually only as good as the software that actually that it connects to, because the smartness is not hardware. The smartness is software. So all Samsung's devices connect back to what's called Smart Media Hub. And just like Disney, they first had sort of planned out what do we need to do to actually support this ourselves in terms of building out buildings around the world. And they had come up with an initial cost picture of CapEx of $34 million. And then they started realizing that, yeah, even if they could build it, they wouldn't be immediately experts in actually running it. And that, you know, the resilience and the reliability of such an environment is crucial, because that is going to be how good your TV is going to be. And so for them, they made the decision that they would go with AWS. So at least they would be able to leverage all the scale, all the reliability, all the fault tolerance, and the worldwide delivery of their software and of their services without that they really had to think about it. And so for them, the immediate cost savings was $34 million. But the reality is that the agility for them now to have a platform in which they can move much faster than that they could be in the past is equally important for them. And so we like to think about, you know, that cloud actually transforms what is possible, things that we were not able to do in the past and which we actually knew we wanted to do differently, yeah, are now suddenly become possible. And so let's go for a few of them. Many of you in the media industry are looking to experiment and deliver new services. Both PBS and Disney indicated this is just the beginning. These kind of devices are kind of driving some of these new approaches to delivering content to customers, but it's all about also finding new ways to actually monetize your content. I just saw a few days ago the staggering fall of advertisement in the print industry, which is close to getting to zero almost. It's a trend that is going down. All newspapers, all those kind of media companies are rapidly looking for how can we actually monetize our content? What are the kind of things that we could do for customers such that we deliver value there? And so in the past, you would not be experimenting that much as a business. Why? Because there would be a huge dollar sign up front for it. Yeah? And so one of the things that I think cloud has really brought is that the cost of failure is going to zero. And by failure, I don't mean a hardware failure. I mean the cost of actually doing an experiment and actually having that experiment not work out is actually, you know, you may have spent a few $100s or maybe a few $1,000s at Amazon, but if you would have invested $100,000 in your hardware environment before you're going to pull the plug on that particular experiment, that's going to be pretty tough. And so be able to move much faster is really important, but also at much lower cost. So one of the a good example there is, for example, the NASDAQ. The NASDAQ is the data group at the NASDAQ takes in all the data that's coming from the exchanges. They store it in a massive archival backend. And sometimes they were asked by their customers, well, can you go back to September 20th of last year and give me all the puts and gets against Amazon at 1:30 in the afternoon? And they would fire up a massive query in their backend, and the results get back an hour later and things like that. And they thought, well, maybe there's a business to be had here, because we get in this request quite a bit. For them to actually sort of build a new business based on their backend, they would have to revamp the backend, and that was something like a $20 million, 3 to 4 year sort of enterprise architecture project. And they thought, no, we're not going to do that, because that's something that we don't even know whether there is a business to be had here at the end. And they took such a simple, embarrassing approach that it's really fun to look at. What they did is they took the fire hose that comes from the exchanges, and they also dump it in Amazon S3. And then they build a sort of an Adobe Air application that customers can run on their desktop, connect to Amazon S3, and then do the analytics themselves. Of course, there's a subscription model below that and things like that. It turns out that it's a popular application. If it wouldn't have been a popular application, if this product would have failed, it would have costed them, I think, something like $25,000 for the development of the app. And they would have spent $500 at Amazon. The cool thing now is that now they have all this data sitting in Amazon. They started about this with 3-4 years ago. And now they've actually put an API on top of it and allow anybody else that is actually running into the AWS cloud to get access to historical market data. Yeah. So here there's a big enterprise thinking that there may be a product out there, but the cost of actually experimenting is just way too high to do this. And they were fortunate doing this on cloud. Actually, I'd like to introduce you to the new global CIO of News International. He has a story to tell as well.
My name's Paul Cheeseborough. I'm the Chief Information Officer here at News International.
My name's Simon Smith. I'm Head of Platform and Data, working in digital technology.
I'm Zen Latigan. I'm CTO for News International.
News International is one of the largest publishers within the UK. We publish The Sun, The Times, and The Sunday Times across all platforms.
The catalyst was there was more and more demand for brands like The Times, The Sunday Times, and The Sun to start entering a digital arena.
The old way of doing things was really based on physical infrastructure and relied heavily on long lead times, very traditional vendors, and it was really leading to the organization taking too long to respond to the customer need.
So a year and a half there was a call made to say we have to refocus staff, refocus the way we think about doing things around technology to address digital services which are changing quite quickly. Amazon Web Services helped us go on a journey from an existing team that knew how to work with devices and infrastructure today, and take them on a journey that they understood how to go to the cloud. Previously, different divisions, like the editorial teams, would become increasingly frustrated by the fact that technology can't give what they need quickly enough.
With the move to any cloud service, we obviously look at things like security and availability as a couple of the key things. We're also looking for partners who have one view of the future and are actually aggressively investing in that view, and AWS was a great fit. So we're using Amazon services across the organization, within the enterprise and within our digital services. About a third of our estate is now running on AWS. 18 months ago, that was 0%. So we're using Amazon in a number of key and strategic initiatives across News International. Big data is a good example of that, where we're capturing and leveraging and analyzing customer behavior across all of our products.
We started initially with just using EC2. We now use S3 for storage.
We were particularly attracted to Elastic MapReduce because it allowed us to get up and running with minimal capital investment. When we're using Elastic MapReduce, this is based on Hadoop technology, we were able to actually start working on real problems in the same day.
One of the most striking benefits we've gained from the relationship with Amazon and working with AWS is our ability now to tap into scale of infrastructure that was outside of our reach.
As you might know, it's very difficult these days to forecast how many people be using a digital service. We can just leverage Amazon's auto-scaling for services that might have to flex up very quickly.
So the commercial and financial advantages that we've seen from the move towards Amazon, clearly a reduction in the capital expenditure. We're not having to invest in Big Tin anymore, and that's dramatically reduced our capital expenditure.
I think we've now entered a lot of new digital channels we never could have previously with our cloud. We now have presences for all our titles across Android, iOS, websites, and we have plans for many, many more going forward.
I've now got my team focused on building the things on the infrastructure rather than actually managing the infrastructure itself, which has been a huge, huge benefit.
One of the things we appreciate about working with Amazon is that it's an ever-changing and evolving platform as well. I think we'll keep evaluating Amazon to see which new technologies and platform capabilities they can make available to us so we can leverage it really quickly.
great. Paul Cheeseborough, the CIO there, he was still there at News International in the UK. He's now the global CIO for News International. I like to believe that his embrace of cloud has made him rise to that particular point. We not only help you build new businesses, we help your career as well. Actually, so News is a very interesting company. I recently was in Australia visiting them. And there, they had the similar story with most of the news properties in Australia. And to actually make a new instantiation of their whole CMS, the whole work environment, to actually start working on a new product, it will cost them 56 days. Yeah, that's basically setting up your dev and test environment, hardware, all the things there. So it took them 6 months to convert that environment to a cloud environment. And now launching a new dev and test environment, they can do in 6 hours. Yeah, that suddenly means that if you can do this in 6 hours, your ability to actually innovate and your ability to start thinking about new products actually changes dramatically. Before this, 56 days. No, you had to be really strong-willed within this organization to start driving towards a new product because it was significant cost, not only in terms of hardware, but also in human cost and time involved to get there. And now with 6 hours, you just do it. Yeah? And more importantly, if it isn't working out, you just pull the plug and it's gone. Poof. Yeah? And I think that's sort of the power of doing a lot of these innovations. So, and new things that are actually successful, that's another sort of transformation, are no longer a problem. Yeah? And if I look, for example, this is a good example. It's an older example already. Animoto was a younger business that launched completely on AWS. What they do, this is sort of a typical startup. You know, this is a group of friends that are in college and that develop algorithms that if you feed a set of images, what they did in college was they take an audio file and they can detect rhythm and mood changes in the audio file. They decide to actually start building an application based on this, a business on top of this. So you can upload the audio file, and you upload a whole set of images, and they will make a slideshow with the music underneath there based on those rhythm and mood changes. Really cool. Actually, they were great. They had an application that was running on the web, and they were running about 50 servers. Yeah, that's about what they were doing. And then sort of at one moment, you see a sort of spike in the number of servers that they were using. Actually, they had about sort of 50,000 customers. They were moderately successful at that time. What they did is they launched Facebook integration. So what did this mean? It means that as a Facebook user, you could point to an album on Facebook, a photo album. You could point to a music file. They would create a video from it and then upload that back into Facebook. And then notify all the friends that were originally in the album that they were now appearing in the video. At that moment, they were signing up 50,000 customers an hour. Yeah? Kind of, this is, by the way, if you do things on Facebook, this is kind of the things that you have to expect. Actually, most marketers love that kind of stuff. Yeah? For them, they had taken one particular approach. They wanted to guarantee that these videos that they were creating were delivered to customers within 5 to 10 minutes. There was a requirement that this should be instant gratification. Yeah? If suddenly 250,000 customers are uploading their images and music files and things like that, they shouldn't be waiting for a day. Yeah? So their infrastructure in the middle needed to be elastic to actually continue to be able to make rendering plans and render and deliver this to customers adaptively. So they were going from say 50 instances that they were running normally to close to 5,000 instances a few days after that they've launched their Facebook integration. Now, all of that has kind of died out again, but they were pretty clear to us. If they wouldn't have had this elastic capability, they would have been out of business. Yeah, customers would have gotten a horrible experience, and they would never have been able to become the successful company that they are now. Now, actually, they have a whole range of additional products that customers really love. They're a young, successful, profitable company. They do lots of things for businesses. They do high-end video. They actually make use of our GPU instances, cluster computes, to actually deliver this high, the HD video really great companies. Just check them out. There's a for free piece as well if you want to experiment with that. This actually, as me as being the CTO of Amazon.com, that bookshop that we also run, actually really applies to as well. You know, if you look at my weekly spikes in terms of traffic on the website, in the past we would have to do capacity planning, and sort of rule of thumb would be to apply about 15% over peak. Yeah, that means that on a normally weekly basis, this would be sort of, you would lose about 30% of your capacity being unused, which is sort of safety stock, plus, you know, the sort of weekly patterns. In November, with at the end of November, of course, being Thanksgiving and Black Monday and Cyber Monday and all these kind of things, you would also run at 15% over the peak, but the peaks would be huge. That means for the month of November, we would be losing about, let's say, 70 to 80% of our capacity sitting there unused, just to be ready for when the peak comes. Now that the Amazon.com's websites all run on AWS, yeah, we no longer have that issue. We scale like this. We scale one server at a time instead of rolling in racks at three different data centers. This is huge. The CFO loves this as well. Yeah? Remember that we've lowered pricing 20 times. There are quarters in which at the end of the quarter, you have a discussion with the CIO and your bill will be lower. Yeah? And of course, you would say that will be your efficiency, of course, that drives that. But it is actually a good thing. Yeah, and I think Kendall really hammered on this one as well. You know, many, many people in the media industry see all of these new devices as being a threat, but they're not. They're actually an opportunity. Yeah, and so you know, traditional way, if your infrastructure is constrained, then you know your innovation will be constrained as well, and you will be, fear and doubt will set in at any moment when a new device will come into the market, and you will actually try to ignore it as long as possible. Instead, if you're actually able to capitalize really on that, all these devices are just opportunities, and the only way to get there is to actually really quickly transcode to all of these devices and to deliver them, gives you great business. I think Netflix is the ultimate example of a company that has really transformed itself to be going from a physical distribution company to a digital media streaming company, targeting as many devices as possible. And so in many of their cases, they were either acquiring new libraries of content that immediately had to be transcoded to be able to be delivered to customers as quickly as possible, or, for example, they will be adding a new device. They will be adding iOS, or they would be using a PS3, and that meant that their whole library would have to be transcoded again for each of those devices in 5 different bit rates, I believe, per device. For them, you know, in those short periods of time, they would need 5 or 10,000 of nodes to actually do the transcoding for them, and for the rest of the year, they couldn't care less. And so for them, it has been really as well a building of help them really build their business as well. Another transformation, I think this is a really important one, may not be if you're more of a product person, this may not really speak to you as much, but in the past, in the old world of IT, we already knew how to build scalable systems, how to make them fault tolerant, how to make them cost efficient. We already knew that. We just didn't do it. And we didn't do it because it was just way too hard. Actually moving hardware around, building multiple data centers, connecting them together, managing all that kind of stuff was just way too hard. All these algorithms that we had developed in research and in companies, we were just not using them to build fault-tolerant systems and scalable systems. Why not? Because it's just hard. It was just hard to deal with the hardware itself. Now, one of the things that cloud has done is that anything that was hardware is now suddenly programmable. It's no longer a piece of hardware, it's a virtualized thing where you never have to leave your desktop to actually access any of those resources. Yeah, and so suddenly there's things like regions, and within regions there are availability zones, which more or less map down to sort of a data center-like isolation unit. And you can put these in multiple availability zones. You can survive all sorts of failure scenarios. Suddenly servers are programmable units. You want five more in another availability zone, it's a click of a button. So all of these algorithms that we knew in the past that we had to use, now suddenly can be used. And we see many, many companies building tremendously new architectures, much more simplified, but much more resilient than what they were in the past. And you know, we have a whole architecture center, actually, to help you there with lots of templates and things like that. But for example, I think bringing up Netflix again, Netflix clearly, you know, is the streaming business is extremely important for them. You know, an outage in that world would be have immediate significant financial impact. I know that because as Amazon.com, we also run a business like that online. If we are not available, then you know, customers don't pay you. And so it has immediate impact on your bottom line. So you have to make sure that this is as resilient as possible. And Netflix built a great tool called the Chaos Monkey. Yeah? The Chaos Monkey is a software component that goes around your infrastructure and shoots random components. Yeah? With the idea that it should have been built in such a way that it can actually survive it. And you should actually search for it if you want to use this in your own organization. They've open sourced it. It's called Symbian Army. It's on GitHub, and you can actually download the open source software from there. Really great stuff. You know, early on I mentioned already this sort of statements that the federal government had made about that security for them, the security of AWS for them was an asset instead of a liability. And so one of the transformations that I've seen as well happening is that another thing that we already knew that this was not the way to secure our cities. Yeah? We've done it for a long time. Yeah? Obviously, if this would have been a good way to secure our cities, we would still be doing it. Yeah? We're obviously not. And so the same thing goes for your systems in your own data centers. Yeah? Firewalls are useful systems to keep the immediate threat out or to keep some control over that. But we already know that to really secure your individual system, each system needs to actually have security built in. Yeah, if you read most of the sort of post-mortem reports about security incidents that are there, the majority of them are insider threats. And not necessarily because individual workers are actually evil. No, they will click on a link in an email that's been sent to them by their by some financial advisor, and they'll click on it, and at that moment there is all sorts of stuff being installed on your PC, and immediately the internal networks are being compromised. And so we already know that each of those systems actually need to protect itself. And so in AWS, when we started building our security stuff, of course, everybody gets the benefit from our rock-solid infrastructure security pieces. Yeah, we have all these certifications, and even as a small company for you, it may have even been impossible to get some of these certifications, but by using the Amazon infrastructure, you get all this, you know, you get the HIPAA certifications, you get SOC, you get all of these certifications that come just with the platform. Yeah? But more importantly, on top of that, you can build your applications and truly secure them exactly in the way that you want to. Yeah? We actually launch any EC2 instance with the whole thing closed off. Yeah? Nobody can access it. It has to be conscious decisions by you, by how you want to open things up. We give you, with using of IAM, the Identity Access Management, very, very fine-grained tools to decide who can do what under which circumstances, from which subnet, at what time, under which conditions. Yeah? Then you are allowed to actually access this object. Yeah? Be able to who your staff in India, the outsourced staff, is allowed to actually start and stop dev and test instances, but not production instances. Yeah, or they are allowed to actually create these objects, but not allowed to delete them. All these kind of things actually give you a whole new set of very fine-grained tools to build security infrastructures that many of our customers had never been able to do before. And as such, there's a great shift from going to just rely on some outside security to actually really relying on managing security yourself at a very fine-grained level. Another transformation I think already mentioned before, I think most, if you build new systems, then I think managing the analytics around it is essential. Yeah, and in the past, it was hard for most folks to actually do really large-scale analytics. First of all, because traditional analytics was all that on forehand, you already knew what kind of questions you wanted to ask, that drove the data model, and that drove the way that you stored things. The new world, especially around if you distribute all this content, and you have all this information, and you really don't really know what you want to know about your customers. So you collect as much data as possible. And why do you collect that much data? Because you believe that by analyzing it, you can create a competitive advantage. But it does mean that you have to deal with, you know, enormous amounts of data, uncertain about how much data that actually is going to be, and also uncertain about how much analytics and how much compute you're going to need to do on top of that. And so for that, cloud is the ideal partner. Yeah, because whenever you need compute, you can get it. Whenever you need storage, you can actually use it, and you can grow it at your own pace. And as such, this is, again, one of those transformations, where in the past you would not do this big data stuff, because it would be too hard. The new world, you actually make it easy for you. We actually make it easy if you do Hadoop as part of your analytics engine to use Amazon Elastic MapReduce to actually fire up Hadoop clusters without having to worry about all the cluster management and things like that. One thing that I want to emphasize is that traditionally, data analytics has been sort of the playground of enterprises. But what you see these days is that there is no young business being started that does not have analytics at its core. Each of these are popular, modern, internet-based companies, all driven by analytics. Yeah, while actually what they present on the outside is different. I mean, Playfish is a gaming company, Etsy is a marketplace, Foursquare is a social check-in service, Yelp is a directory. But all of them, under the covers, are driven by analytics. And all of it, there is no young business started today that doesn't start off with actually collecting data and analyzing data at the same time. Many of them follow a sort of a lean approach where, just like Amazon does, you bring a product into the market of your customers very quickly with a minimum feature set and then start evolving that. But to be able to evolve it, you have to measure. You have to understand. And for example, an area that gets a lot of attention these days, for example, Channel 4 in the UK has a whole range of applications that are sort of second screen applications that can run on your iPad while you're watching television. Nobody knows how this world is going to evolve. Yeah, and so for them, it's really important to collect as much data about customer behavior as possible to try and figure out whether their applications actually are making sense. And so analytics plays a really important role there. And I want to close off with sort of my last observation there. So these devices, yeah, as cool as they are, if I would know where the on-off button was, yeah, they're really cool. Yeah. In the past, this would have been a nightmare. Much, much bigger nightmare than that there is now. Now you may see many of these devices as being a sort of a threat to how do I deal with it. In the past, you could only use those devices by actually loading content on the device. Yeah, there was no network device, there was no streaming, there was nothing like that. If you wanted to listen to your music, you actually had to copy the music onto the device. Yeah? These devices are just going to be a window to content. Yeah? When I, in the gym, at the hotel, step onto my treadmill, I want that treadmill to immediately change into my content hub. Yeah, I will immediately get all my video, all my music, the books that I'm reading, the newspapers that I'm subscribed to. It needs to immediately appear at my treadmill. Yeah, I will be sitting at home. I will be reading my Kindle in a book. I step in the car. The car continues to read the book to me. Yeah, while I'm driving to the shop, and I'm in the shop, and I'm actually standing in line, and I pull out my phone, I want to continue to read where I just was. Yeah, content will no longer be restricted to devices. They will no longer be locked into those devices. Yeah? Cloud plays an enormous important role here to make sure that customers will have access to all content that they own, wherever they are, and independent of these kind of devices. Yeah, now there is probably the US market consists of 6 or 7 devices, something like that. In reality, there are going to be hundreds, thousands of those devices around the world, different formats. And so it is important that content can be independent of those devices. And cloud is the place where actually customers can keep their devices and be connected to it. So content will be freed from the devices and will continue to live in the cloud forever. With that, yeah, this is sort of, when we launched AWS, that's now 6 years ago, we actually launched it with a mission. Yeah, and the mission was to enable businesses and developers to use web services, what we now know as the cloud, to help them build scalable, sophisticated applications. I'm not really sure whether 6 years ago we had a true understanding of the kind of impact, both on technology side as well as on the business side, that we would have with our offering. But you know, I still believe it's only day one. Yeah, the kind of things that we're doing is only has set in motion many, many things in way that you're going to be developing very new applications and actually surprise the world with them. With that, thank you very much.